Welcome to Palm Sunday Worship. I'm Amy Morgan, and I'm so glad that you've decided to join us here for worship this morning. And I hope that you will join us for all of our Holy Week services, Maundy, Thursday, and Good Friday at 6:30, and then on Easter Sunday, modern worship at 10:45 and traditional at 11. Today for Palm Sunday, we'll focus on the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. Some of our music has been pulled from last year's Palm Sunday worship, and we hope you enjoy it. And so now let's turn our hearts and minds to the worship of God.
Thank you. Let us join together now in saying the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. God, we come to Palm Sunday looking at the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem and longing to feel that kind of triumph in our hearts. These are hard days, and there's nothing that feels very triumphant and encouraging right now. And yet we know that in the midst of all of it, you are here. We know that you are present. And so, God, into our concerns about the future, be present with us. Into our worry for friends and family members and for people we don't even know, bring your peace. Into our uncertainty, bring the assurance that you are here. We pray for those who are struggling with illness. We pray for those who are living in grief, the grief of a lost loved one, the grief of lost jobs, the underlying grief that is for all of us in this time. We pray for those who are worried about where the next meal will come from, those for whom sheltering in place doesn't feel safe. And we pray, Lord, that in the midst of us, you would show us ways, even as we are staying at home, that you would show us ways to pour your love into the world and to reach out to our neighbors and our friends in care. Lord, fill us with your love, perfect love that overcomes fear, and keep our eyes focused on you, that in this time we might find our relationship with you strengthened and we might find ourselves more faithful in all that we do. We lift this prayer and all of our prayers in the name of Jesus, and we pray together that prayer that you taught us. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. In these days, our church has been busy at work. We have people making masks. We have people serving and donating food to those folks who are most vulnerable. We are supporting our partners in ministry, and all of that, in addition to these online worship services, is happening because you are generous and you are giving. And so whether you give by Shelby Next or on our church website, or whether you mail a check in, we appreciate your generosity as you invest in the ministries that God is doing through Oak Grove.
Thank you. Our scripture for this morning is the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. When Jesus and his disciples had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately send them." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. And a very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, we have come to Palm Sunday, and we get to witness what is called the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. The triumphal entry is often thought in Christian circles to be a very humble action where Jesus is coming, riding into the city on a lowly donkey, an animal we associate with farm work and humble activities like agriculture. However, wider readers of the Bible, especially the Old Testament, know that what we are watching on Palm Sunday is a coronation ceremony. When it was unclear to Solomon's mother and the high priest Nathan who would be king after David, they went to the ill King David who was at home in bed and they said, "We thought that you had intended Solomon to be king after you. Why then is his brother Adonijah declaring himself king?" The solution to that situation was that David instructed in 1 Kings 1, 32 through 35, that Nathan take his own donkey, David's own donkey, and go down to the valley below the city of Jerusalem, and to put Solomon on it, and to have him ride into the city, and have everyone declare when he reached to the top of the city wall, "Solomon is king." So that entry into Jerusalem was the introduction to the city of David's heir and the next king of Israel. In another story, in 2 Kings 9, verse 13, we see Jehu, who is a commander of the army of northern Israel, being greeted by a prophet who anoints him king. And when he comes out of the back room and greets his generals, they ask him what the prophet said to him. And he said, "Well, you know those crazy people and how they talk." He said, "I anoint you king over Israel." And as soon as he said that, everyone in the room took off their cloaks and laid them on the ground in front of Jehu and declared him king. So this action of entering into the city and being acclaimed by the population, and even the action of putting people's cloaks on the road in front of the one who was to be king, these are all symbols of a coronation of a new monarch. Some in the crowd didn't even know, most likely, who was coming into town when they saw this happening. Imagine if somebody today were to decide to stage an inauguration parade, were to get a long limousine and walk in front of it with their wife or husband, and have some guys walking alongside them dressed like Secret Service men, and say that the limousine had "Hail to the Chief" playing out the windows of the car. How many people would gather along the sidewalk in Washington, D.C. to watch this go down Pennsylvania Avenue? They might not understand what was happening, but they would understand the symbolism. How many people would come out to watch that? I imagine several hundred. And how many in that crowd would be there just for fun, would be singing along "Hail to the Chief" just because it seemed absurdist to them or humorous to them? This is likely what's happening in the crowd in Jerusalem on the first Palm Sunday. Some of the people in the crowd are just there because it's interesting. Perhaps they're shouting Psalm 118, "Hosanna, Son of David," which is the inauguration psalm, by way of our concept. We have "Hail to the Chief." They had Psalm 118. Some are most likely singing along as a joke or because they find it interesting. We can't assume that everyone in the crowd knew who Jesus was, or owned him as Messiah, or appreciated what he was doing. Some were just there out of interest. And as we all know, human emotion and human affections are very fickle things. This is one of the reasons why, when we come to Palm Sunday in our calendar, it's important for us to remember, while we love seeing Jesus hailed as King, we have to remember that some of the same people in the crowd who are singing Hosanna, Son of David today, will be in the crowd on Friday that shouts, Crucify Him. Human beings do not always hold their allegiance. This is one of the reasons why I love one of the symbols of Palm Sunday, which I learned as a child in the Catholic Church. On Palm Sunday morning in the Catholic Church, you would be given one of these palm frond leaves, not the kind we often use to wave that have, you know, branches, but ones that are long and thin. This is actually a leaf off an iris plant in my garden. But one of the things you do on Palm Sunday in this tradition is fold the long, thin palm frond into the shape of a cross in order to remind yourself that Palm Sunday is today, but Good Friday is coming. For the next week, let us keep solemn observance of Jesus' path to the cross. Let us meditate on how our faithfulness can falter. Let us feel with him the sorrow that comes from loving those who reject you. For the next week, let us keep in the forefront of our minds each day between now and Friday, and the days between Friday and Easter Sunday. These were the darkest hours of the Savior's life, and perhaps the most meaningful. We can join in this practice by reading the scripture, starting in Matthew 21 and going through the end of the gospel. This is the week of Christ's suffering on our behalf. So let us watch and pray along with him and remember the sacrifices that our Lord made for us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please join with us in our sending hymn, In the Cross of Christ I Glory.
I'm glad you could be with us this Sunday for this Palm Sunday service, and I hope you will join us again later on this week. We will have Bible study at 2 o'clock with me on Tuesday. We will have spiritual practices with Amy at 2 on Thursday. We will also have 2 extra Holy Week services this week. For the service on Thursday, it involves sharing food and drink with the members of your family in your home. So before the service starts on Thursday evening, collect something simple that your family can share to eat and drink in the middle of the service. Anything will do, milk and cookies, coffee and donuts, cheese and crackers, whatever it is you happen to have will be fine. We will have a love feast after the old Moravian style, which is a sort of family shared meal that you do in your home. We will broadcast a version of that service on Thursday evening at 6:30. And on Friday evening at 6:30, we will present a Good Friday service. Again, we hope you will contact us if you have any concerns or any needs that we should know about. We will continue to keep the church closed as long as we need to for our health and for public safety. But we long to be with you and know that you're in our hearts and our minds. Now go forth to be in the world, to love God and your neighbor in all that you do. And may God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you. Amen.